This is an interview with Gloria Molina, a longtime public servant from Southern California, first Latina elected to the California State Assembly, first Latina elected to the Los Angeles City Council, and first Latina elected to the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors, among many of her other accomplishments that she has had. This is March 8th, 2017. I'm Luis Fraga. Gloria, welcome to Notre Dame.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
I want to ask you a few questions about your career.
Okay.
And your life and your background. Can you tell us what you think was the catalyst to your deciding to enter a life of public service?
I don't know if there was any one thing or anything. I mean, my parents, very traditional kind of Mexican, they probably had a very traditional kind of upbringing. And so while they were involved where they voted and they took an interest in politics and what was going on, other than being good Democrats and good voters was probably the only direction they really gave us. Mine came out of volunteering, being in the community, watching things that I knew were wrong, that I thought could be corrected, that could be simply corrected by good policy, good legislation, and always confronting folks that just found it too difficult to do or not interested in doing it. That's what motivated me to stay involved. Although I always saw myself as more of a policymaker, I wanted to be the person that wrote the legislative bills or got involved in strategy for passing good legislation, never the upfront, the politician. And I became the politician, but it wasn't certainly, if I had any aspiration, it was always to be behind the scenes, to be the political consultant.
Mm-hmm. When you ran for your first office in 1982, was it 81, 82?
82,
80, basically. In 1982, you ran for the California State Assembly.
That's correct.
And won, was that your first attempt at elective office?
Yes, it was. It stemmed from our interest as a group of women who wanted to see a woman in the U.S. Congress, and regrettably that didn't happen, and we couldn't make that happen. But then the seat came up in my own backyard, and that was my first run, and I was very fortunate to win. I think had I not won, I probably would have had to have moved out of town because I made people very angry because I decided to run.
Because you were running against... Were you running against someone who had been identified as the preferred candidate of the then-existent political establishment?
The political powers, which were all men, Latinos, basically had already decided what candidate was who was going to run and who they were going to support, and they weren't very open to a woman candidacy at all. And we had found that when we had asked about getting a seat for a woman in Congress, getting the first Latina Mexicana to represent us in the U.S. Congress, and they denied us then. And so the second opportunity was when there was a seat that would be available for the legislature, and that's at that point in time when we decided, or collectively we said, we had to make a run for it and make a good run and hopefully get elected and show them that we too had to be at the table when it came to decision making.
So were your, in that campaign, that first campaign, were most of your volunteers, campaign workers, the group that supported you and supported your candidacy, were they largely Latinas? Were they largely women? Were they largely Mexicanas?
That was the bulk of them. But I must say I had worked with so many men in the community that they joined me as well in raising money and even getting on the phone, coming and working on the campaign. My first campaign manager was a male. My political consultant was a female, but I also had a male consultant as well. So we had a mix of people, but I think they all understood how important this race was and what we were trying to say and what we needed to do. So collectively, they all had the same passion and the same interest and understood how critically important it was in the community. So, but we had a mix, but the majority of them were Latinas.
And why hadn't more Latinas run for office?
Well, first of all,
before then, from Southern California.
Well, first of all, I think that the men have always created this kind of situation that happens all of the time, is that they decided that they're first, and they decided that they're the ones that wield the power, like makes most of these decisions. We certainly had confronted that when I was part of the Chicano movement and as a student in college. And so that's a tendency to go there. And so we had to stand up aggressively against our men to let them know that we saw this battle and the situation as being a a barrier, just as racism is a barrier to our opportunity, so is sexism. And it was interesting that men who had been victims of discrimination, of racial discrimination, could turn around and discriminate against women. But they did, and we needed to let them know that that was not tolerated by us, and that's why it was important to have a good campaign. We were very fortunate to win the campaign, and it really set a different standard where they no longer could say no to women running for these seats. Again, they still had their interest, and they still pursue, you know, their own colleagues or their male counterparts to run. But at the same time, there are contenders who, and I have been followed in the legislature by some tremendous women who have gone on not only to serve in Congress, but have gone on to serve on the cabinet of this country. So I'm very proud of the kind of door that I've opened for others.
And you were outspent, I'm going to guess, in that first campaign.
At least 3-1.
So you were outspent 3-1, but you must have had a tremendous organizational infrastructure or a set of volunteers. How would you talk to us a little bit about what you remember about that first campaign?
Well, first of all, we did have to raise some baseline money, and so I, you know, pulled out the old Rolodex that was then and called up everyone we knew and begged for money. We didn't get big checks, but we got a lot of checks, small checks. But the reality was that we needed to do two things. We needed to have a mail campaign of mail that we were going to send to voters. Not all of it was going to be done electronically as it done today. Most of it was handwritten postcards. I had volunteers who came in every evening and rewrote small postcards to everyone. They were personalized. We had volunteers that made phone calls. We didn't have, you know, anybody that we paid to do all of this. Volunteers came in every day. And I took time off from work at that time for 3.5 months, and I walked door to door. I walked the district 1.5 times. So every single day, it was, yep, I had to walk every single part of the district, all the precincts, and try and collect door to door. And people were shocked that I was walking up to their door. And they remember, you came to my door, you came to my grandfather's door. They talk about it and personally left a postcard. We had a very, very terrific get out the vote operation. So we did put together all of the elements of a grassroots campaign. Like I said, outspent, but we weren't outgunned. And that was what brought us to at least having a fighting chance. And then that day, you know, it was just a matter of who was going to pull out the vote and where we were going to get it from, and keeping our fingers crossed so we were successful on Election Day.
You, in the course of your career, have confronted varieties of gender discrimination. Your decision to run for office against someone who had been identified by the powers that be. What would you say have been two of the most significant instances of gender-based discrimination in your public life and your public responsibilities that you've had to confront course of your career?
There's so many. I mean, the reality is, I shared earlier that, you know, It even as an elected official, you face sexism and racism. I had a colleague that welcomed me on the floor of the legislature on my very first day and said how wonderful it was for me to join the legislature, because now they had somebody who was going to be able to really be an aggressive fighter for bilingual education and child care, which really was very sexist and very racist from the standpoint that they had already relegated me into my role instead of here I'm going to be involved in all these issues and so on. And there were, from time to time, there were incidents in, I traveled with other elected officials to Portugal and Britain. And I remember being discriminated against by one of the gentlemen who couldn't remember my name but decided to call me Maria. And I found that very, very derogatory and very racist, instead of getting to know who I was and so on. You feel discrimination every step of the way. Many times people are saying no to you and they really are just discriminating against you. But again, you can't live with that. You can't operate and function that way. You can't walk around with that chip on your shoulder. Instead, you've got to move forward. You've got a job to do. Now you're elected. You're responsible. And no matter what, you've got to remember you have a voice. You have a vote. You have the brain to make a strategy and to overcome those things. And so you've got to work around it. But you can't forget that it's there. because that gives you the kind of ammunition and gives you the fortitude to continue fighting for those issues. Because even today, we think we've accomplished so much that there is no gender discrimination, that people are not racist. That is not the case. It's still there, sometimes more subtle than in other opportunities. But very frankly, you've got to recognize that. You can't operate and function and allow yourself to be overcome by those issues because you've got work to do. You've got a duty.
You've served and been elected to office, as we said earlier, in three different positions, right? The State Assembly in California, the LA City Council, and the LA County Board of Supervisors. Which of those three positions did you enjoy the most? And
well, the
why?
Latter. The latter. Certainly, as a member of the Board of Supervisors, it gave me the range of things to work on. I am very hands-on. I'm detail-oriented. So in the legislature, you legislated. But you didn't get to implement the law. You didn't get to see how it functioned and how it worked. Did it succeed at doing what you were trying to do legislatively? So you were just, you basically put the laws on the books and you weren't involved in implementation. You could monitor them if you wanted to in your own time. But for the most part, you got involved in the next legislative session and getting involved in that, those responsibilities. When I was in the city council, I really enjoyed being closer to home and being closer to people and really kind of touching and being a part of everyday life and some of the issues there. Although, again, the range was very limited because it was land use issues and traffic issues and the budget issues. And it really wasn't a lot of the social justice issues and things that I cared about as much. But it was good being home and being in touch with people and getting to see and being able to implement changes. So when I got to the Board of Supervisors, the range was wonderful. You're legislative, you're executive, and you're still a political servant to people. So I got the range of all of it, and I really enjoyed it. So you did legislate and had policy that you put in place, but you also implemented it. You had to find the money to pay for the program. You had to watch it and monitor it and make sure it was effectively operating. And you had the opportunity to change it if you needed to, as well as being out there in the community to see firsthand how things were working and functioning and how they could be made better. So that by far was the best.
And would you advise anyone who is interested in running for office to think of first starting smaller, as I think it's fair to say you did in running for the state of some in terms of the size of the district
sure.
and the constituency and working your way up? Or what advice would you give to someone who's interested in running for office?
In someone who's interested in running for office, I think that you have to have a tangible connection to your district and to your constituents. People have to know you. They have to build trust. You have to demonstrate to them that you are the kind of leader that they can vote for, support, and have confidence in. So at a local level is always a good thing. School boards, community college, city council, depending on where you are and what you're doing. It's really hard to step in and say, I'm going to run for Congress and just not from nowhere. Hopefully you have some political experience along the way that I think you could move into it. But you never know. I mean, there's opportunity, but almost everyone I've seen that's worked their way up to Congress or other kind of office of that type has served an elected position before. So you need to start at a local level. But I always think that it's very smart to be really in touch with your constituents, to have a place where you are. Because as leaders, we have to understand we are exactly that, public servants. And the duty and responsibility of the people that you need to serve is critically important. And what happens when you go into a position like Congress or even the legislature, they pull you away from your constituency. You can get so caught up in the Beltway or in the life of Sacramento and forget about what problems everyday people are having, and they're significant to them, and you need to be a part of resolving them. So I really encourage people to be involved in some kind of a local campaign and local issues.
You have spoken a number of times. In fact, I quote you in one of an article that I published about how you understand your representational responsibilities. You've run from districts that have sizable numbers of Latinos, but mm-hmm. not ever just Latinos in those communities.
True.
And you've spoken about how you see your responsibilities to represent all of your constituents and to try to understand all of your constituents. Could you talk to us a little bit about how you see, as a Latina woman, how you see your representation, have seen your representational responsibility?
Well, first of all, I mean, certainly when I decided to run for office, it was to make a point. It was, you know, not just running for that seat. We wanted to demonstrate to our community that a Latina could get elected, that she could run a credible campaign, that a Latina should be at the table when making these decisions. That was the purpose, that was the goal, that was the vision that we had. But once elected, you had a different set of responsibilities and duties. Excuse me, we were very critical. The first one being that you had a group of constituents. Many of them may not have voted for you, but at the end of the day, you were their elected representative. So you had to go out and listen. You had to be part of that community. And even if they didn't like what you had to say and what you had to do or what your priorities were, that you were listening to them and you were trying to find a way to resolve their issues and be a part of it. I have always been in touch with my constituents. I think the most important thing that any elected official does is to have a mechanism to talk to their constituents, either that they trust that they can call your office, that you're going to resolve their issues, that you're going to have a mechanism to stay in contact with them, that you're going to listen to them. That's their, besides legislating and all of the other kinds of things that we do as elected officials, travel and all those things, the most important thing is to have a mechanism to let them know that you're in touch with them. And again, you don't say, well, you didn't vote for me anyway, or I'm not going to go to that neighborhood because they didn't support me. That's not the way it operates. Once you're elected, it is your duty to find a way to clear the path. Again, they may never vote for you again. But for the most part, I have found that I have been able to work with people who are not of my party, Republicans that, you know, I have a different point of view and philosophy, conservatives that I have a different point. But at the same time, there are things that we have in common. We have goals that we want to achieve together. There's a part of being an elected representative that you realize that really so many of us care about the good things, the quality of life of
things
a community.
Like quality of
that's
life.
Right. You know, things that we do to enrich ourselves in our families, in our schools, in our environment. There's so many things that we can find common ground on, even though we're different political parties and at the end of the day still may not like each other personally, but we respect each other as constituents and as an elected official. I think that's the most important thing that we do.
What do you see as the primary difference between, if there is one, based on your experience and all the years that you served, between male and female elected officials?
Well, there is a difference, and that's just not true across the board. But but for the most part, men seem to operate very, very differently because they've had different experiences in their life than women have. Women have a very different, more of a collective approach to governing. They understand, and it's because of their upbringing, their nurturing, their responsibilities as mom and wife, and you know all of those kinds of things. I think that they have they come from a different kind of an upbringing, so consequently they govern differently. So they are more effective. They talk more in the term of we instead of I. Men are more oriented to me and myself and my position. And that's been across the board. So women are a little different. I'm not saying everyone, but for the most part, we govern differently. We care about things differently. We're in the details. It's what we do. In fact, to a point that it might be annoying to our male colleagues in many respects. We want to know how things work, and we want to question what's going on. And we don't just accept everything that is said to us. So there's a little bit of a difference. And there are times, you know, there's exceptions to all of it. But for the most part, that's why I think we're a healthy component to the political process. And as I think across the board, women need to be at every single table where decisions are being made. Our input, while I'm not saying it should be the majority, our input is significant. And it's usually a little different than the male point of view. And so when it comes to governing, I think we bring so much more of a skill set that is diverse and different from men.
What would you say is the biggest difference between Latino and Latina elected officials, based on your experience?
Well, I think that, again, regrettably, you know, Latino men are brought up to be, quote, the macho, in charge of power. I'm in charge of these things. And they, even though doesn't certainly manifest itself that way. At the end of the day, the woman's doing all of the work. And those have been the traditions, regrettably. So they have that upbringing, regret. And it's changing now as we are raising more of our children to become, you know, more oriented to recognizing that there shouldn't be a gender, you know, division at all, that it's all equal. But the reality is that men come from that. And so consequently, we have to be a little bit more assertive sometimes. We have to be much more aggressive to get our point of view across. We have to let them know. And again, there are some people who are very good. They understand it. They're inclusive. They do all that. And then others who just have a tough time. I mean, I have heard men speak about women and women legislate. Oh, I can't handle it. I just didn't even like the sound of her voice. That's like, you know, it's just annoying. They're annoyed by those kinds of things instead of, but it's important what she said, you know. So there is a difference. And in Latinos, it's their upbringing. It's been the it's the way they've been raised for the most part. And so consequently, they do we're to be protected. We're supposed to be, you know, helped and assisted in that way. And they don't see it as a negative thing. They're being supportive in their own way. But we like them to look at us as equals, that we can, you know, handle these things, and we're entitled to be at the table, and we expect our position and our voice and our input to be respected and taken into consideration.
What would you say was your proudest accomplishment in each of the three arenas of government where you've served as an elected official? The assembly, a piece of legislation or a cluster of legislation that you pursued in the city council and on the county board of supervisors? Take your time.
Sure.
Whatever way you wish.
Well, certainly when I was in the legislature, my hope was that I was going to go into the legislature and start getting more policy-oriented responsibilities to making schools take ownership of high school graduation, that it was every school's responsibility to graduate all of their children, to at least get a high school diploma, to bring more accountability to it. It'd been sort of lackadaisical from the standpoint that if they drop out, they drop out, and, you know, there were no consequences to parents, to anyone. Yet at the end of the day, the consequences to a neighborhood and a community were unbelievable, let alone to the individual himself. So I authored a series of bills on high school dropouts that I was very proud of. They received bipartisan support, and they were very good bills that could have gone and would have made a very dramatic difference as to education at that time. And I worked very hard on it for a number of years and received, like I said, bipartisan support. Regrettably, they were vetoed by the governor.
Which governor was this?
Governor Duke Machen at the time, because he and even my colleagues in my own party had decided that they should put a prison in East Los Angeles, which is a district I represented, and that was not acceptable to me or to my community. I mean, we didn't need another negative project, but they were looking for someone who would not going to have a problem, supposedly, putting a prison in their backyard. And so I objected to it, and of course, the punishment at the end of the day was that the governor vetoed my bill. So that was really a painful part. I did author other legislation, but by heart, that was the biggest highlight. But it also gave me the kind of validation in my community that I really was representing their interest, and that it was really important that I'm not going to let them, that this kind of a project, I was not going to acquiesce to those powers that be, that we were going to stand firm against it. And of course, when I went on to the city council, that argument continued. It was closer to home. And I was able to file at that time a lawsuit as the city, saying that the siting of this prison was inappropriate in this area near schools and so on, which at the end of the day frustrated the governor and the speaker of the legislature at that time, because that's how we won. We won in court at the end of the day, so that they weren't able to cite a prison. I think that legislatively they almost passed it, but we were able to block it when I was on the city council. But on the city council, I did a lot of things in affordable housing, which is another passion that I had. And asked the city council to take on a housing department, that I felt that our responsibility to development in as we were always looking and, you know, land use issues and so on, that we needed to start incorporating affordable housing into all of the development components that we were doing. Finding a way, because the reality was that It was just becoming scarce, and it's more scarce now than ever. And so we needed to create policies as to how the city was going to start looking at building affordable housing and encouraging developers to build affordable housing, to have, as we called it, inclusive zoning at the time. So that was one of the things that I did, and I was very proud of it. Didn't stay there long enough, but I did an awful lot of things in that whole area of affordable housing, as well as in law enforcement. I really believe that in the community, we need to have safe neighborhoods and making sure that children can safely walk to school. We need to get rid of all the graffiti and all the gang issues and all that we could. So it was tough on crime as well because I was working directly on those issues. So that when I went on to the Board of Supervisors, it just transferred for me to do all of those crime issues, to be involved in those things and to secure our communities and provide safety, because that's what everybody wants, a good quality of life in their neighborhood. But I got very, very involved in the County Board of Supervisors in budgeting, which if you think about, if you really care and have passion about the social issues, when you are governing, when you are responsible to carry out all of those duties, you have to have a good budget document. You have to know how you're going to raise the money to pay for these programs, how you're going to have accountability to make sure you're spending the money correctly, how you're going to plan for the future. One of the largest employers in the region, I mean, we had the largest employer for all of the entire Los Angeles region, we had to be responsible to make sure that we're paying fair wages, that we're providing supportive services and making sure that they had health care and all the things that are so expensive as an employer, and yet at the same time, maintaining their pensions that they could trust and so on. So budgeting and being accountable and bringing forth a good budget was a very essential part of my contribution. I put in a lot of guidelines as to how to have a responsible budget, making decisions on how to provide pensions, but making sure we weren't so overly generous. Sometimes the labor unions weren't very happy with me because I just wasn't going to give them all that they wanted, because we had to look at the bottom line. And so accountability was a very important part of what I brought to LA County. I remember, again, in lots of issues, accountability. We're sued all the time, either in malpractice because of we had all of our hospitals and all of that, or in issues with the sheriff and other things. So I started looking at prevention. How do we prevent from these lawsuits and having them look at it differently? Lawyers have always been, oh, well, we just provide a defense. But instead, let's start looking at it differently. Let's start looking at it. Let's not create that situation. How do we prevent? You're always going to have malpractice, but how do you minimize those kinds of, because these lawsuits could take away a good deal of your budget that could instead go into programming for prevention or other kinds of supportive services for our constituents.
You several times, and consistent with what you just described, and thank you very much for doing that, have described yourself as a policy progressive and a fiscal conservative.
I am.
Could you talk to us a little bit more about that? Because those two are not usually associated with one another.
Right.
And it's something that makes your legislative leadership distinct, I think.
Well, again, like I said, in Los Angeles County, we were totally broke in 1994. We were not on the verge of bankruptcy, but we were, as I used to say, getting close to go over the cliff. Our health care costs were exceedingly high. We were having such problems with maintaining libraries and lifeguards on their beaches and things of that sort. Financially, we were in a really tough situation, making those tough decisions, you know, about what we were going to fund and so on, which was not a healthy thing, because the reality is so much of it were entitlements, our welfare program, our health care programs. So how were we going to bring more accountability? So after going through that very, very rough time and looking at the opportunities, I really wanted us to think of our budget in three-year cycles, not just every year, even though we budget every year legally, but really, how are we going to pay for things in the future? What do we need to plan for? How do we take care of our sewer system? How do we take care of water quality and things of that sort? That isn't just an immediate thing. It's a long-term and a prevention thing. So I was very involved in those issues. And so bringing, I think, more of a light to the budget and not just letting the people in the background do all the work and the departments do all that. We needed to bring it to the forefront and do more planning. So that was a very essential part of it. So that meant that you had to say no to sometimes very good people that wanted a lot, pensions that they wanted to be overly generous, that just at the end, if you took it out and trended it out, you know, wait a minute, we're not going to be able to pay for it in this year. It's going to be a good deal of our budget. We can't afford that, so let's not offer that. Sometimes not giving the salary increases and so on, or all the benefits, not creating very rich programs that we didn't know how we were going to pay for, even though we might get a grant for 3 years. What are we going to do year 4, 5, and 6? So thinking like that. And of course, and being a liberal on social issues is that you do want to take care of everything. You want to make sure that if you're providing a welfare system, that it has integrity, that people are getting really the kind of benefits that they need, that if you're taking care of children, that you're providing all of the services that they need. If a child is taken away from their parents, the trauma that they're going through, the mental health services that they're going to need, surrounding them with the kind of services that are very, very expensive, but very essential. So you have, if you really want to take care of all of those kinds of things and be the provider of all of those people in need, you have to be a conservative when it comes to the budget. You have to make sure every single one of your nickels count for everything that you do, which I think is again, when I look at my mother, my father was the one that did all the work at home, and he's the one that went out to work every single day. My mom stayed home, but my mom was the financial manager of our house, and she watched every nickel, and she knew what was coming in and what was going out and how we were going to get everybody the shoes that they needed, how we were going to get food on the table.
Family of 10, right?
That's right. We had a family of 10 with a very meager income, and yet we were pretty well off from the standpoint of getting everything that we needed to survive. I mean, we didn't even realize we were poor most of our lives. And so, but she was the financial manager, and so I've always found that it's really important to really have an eye on where does the money come from, how are we going to pay for it, but at the same time making sure that we are as progressive as we can on the issues that are important to neighborhoods and communities. Things like libraries and our parks and protecting our environment are very important parts of our well-being.
You, in doing all of this work and your early career in the 70s and the community organizing, the student organizing that you did, and Chicano organizations, and then certainly your elective office in 1982 and the subsequent position that you've
had,
you have lived the rise in political power of Latino communities in Southern California, if not in the entire state.
Absolutely.
You were there. You were one of the leaders. You fought the battles and won many and maybe lost a few.
Right.
And so, as you look back on it now, what do you think of? Or, you know, did you understand at that time that that's what was happening?
Absolutely.
Were you
not
part of it? Just wondering now that you've been retired for a couple of years now
it's almost been four years.
How do you reflect on that now?
Yeah, I look back on it, and I didn't realize I was such a pioneer because I was just doing what needed to be done at that time, and we didn't look at it. We're going to make history. We're going to change this. We didn't look at it. We got to do this otherwise. And so, but I look at it now, and I'm impressed with myself. I mean, because we made some significant changes and you know, broke that glass ceiling, as they say, for the most part, opened that door. And, you know, I look at myself and I said, God, I was a warrior at that time. I mean, every day was a fight. Everything was a battle. It wasn't easy. And opened up a lot of opportunity, a lot of doors. And so I feel proud of the work that I've done. I've always been grateful for what has come my way and my opportunities that I have had. But I really am grateful. I love talking to young people who'll say, oh, my grandmother voted for you. She was so proud of you. Or my mom voted for you. And, oh, you know, you taught my aunt and you inspired her and you motivated me to do this. It's so wonderful to know. I mean, when you're doing it and when you're a part of it, you don't think of it because you had your elders at your time that you looked to, and I did, for their advice and their counsel, and I'm one of the elders, you know, who's there, and it's wonderful to see that people are moving forward. I'm so impressed with young people today. I think that there's just so much promise out there. There's no doubt we need to provide guidance to them, give them direction, and help them along the way, and hopefully be good mentors for them, because they're the promise, and what their responsibility for leadership is going to be 10 times what it was for myself and others. And so I'm proud of the work that I did, the contribution that I made. At the time, it didn't feel like I was just doing what needed to be done at the time, didn't look at it that way. But now when I reflect back on it, it's pretty impressive, and from the standpoint that, you know, as a poor kid, you know, totally Spanish-speaking when I entered school, couldn't work, couldn't go to college when I graduated from high school. I had to work to support my family, but made it through and got through all of it, and was able to, you know, get elected and be articulate and be a fighter for my community and care about governing. And that's the other part of it. It isn't just being elected. You've got to do the job. And so I cared about the issues of government and the accountability and the integrity and the responsibility that went with it. So I look back on it and I feel fairly accomplished, and I feel that I made a solid contribution.
You were, perhaps still are, certainly were known as a center of political power in Southern California. You helped recruit people to run for public office.
Yes, I did.
And helped support people, mm-hmm. candidates mm-hmm. who you believed in. What did you look for as you decided? I'm sure many people came to you for your endorsement.
Many times.
Many people, and you made choices.
And I made
among
choices.
Very good. What were you looking for that was special?
Well, I think that I needed to see elected or people who really had a grassroots connection. I think they had to be rooted in the community, because in our community, we still are still not at the level of many of our contemporaries. We still, educationally, we're far behind. Employment, underemployment. Our opportunities are still limited. And so you really had to, in order, if you didn't come from the community, you were not going to understand that struggle. And that struggle is still there. So I always wanted to have someone who had a clear understanding of that. Now, I don't always have not always made the best choices, because I sometimes supported people, and when they got into office, it was more of a facade than really being rooted in the community, which is a shame. I should have dug a little deeper. But I did think it was my responsibility to promote those people, to lend my name to their effort to run for office, and then hopefully give advice, certainly not control, because I hated the idea of being a power controller and telling them what to do, and I'm in charge and you should follow what I do. I wanted them to evolve in their own, to empower themselves. And there are a lot of wonderful people that we supported in that regard who have run on to elected office, both men and women. And it's something that I've done, and plus empower our own community to become registered to vote, to get out there and vote, to understand the responsibility. And more so, I'm still fighting every single day. There are too many people who still rely on people giving them, as I call them, cheat sheets of who am I going to vote for. Oh, okay, so this labor union says this. Oh, this teachers group says this. Instead of read what's going on, go to candidate forums, listen to what people are saying, call their offices, ask questions. We really, serious, voting is, and people who give you their vote, it's a very serious thing. And so it isn't just moving people forward and getting them elected, but accountability goes with it as well. And there are people that I wish I had never supported or gotten elected into office because I don't think they served us well. I'm not going to mention their name. And then there are other people who just blossomed like you can't believe, that have done so much and have been so effective. And then there are some that didn't win, and that's okay, because they continue to be part of the grassroots and continue to organize and do good work. You don't have to be in elected office to be successful in our community. You can provide leadership on a level that still can make a dramatic difference and inspire many a person in our community, which is a very healthy thing.
So you're someone who has, and I think, correct me if I'm not characterizing it correctly, tremendous faith in our political process and our political system and our political institutions.
I do.
Why?
Well, first of all, I'm you know, there's still always a lot of things to fix. I can criticize, like the next person, this could be better, this could be stronger, this can be done. But until you get involved in the process and understand the complexity of doing these things, you really are not in a position to criticize all that dramatically. You have to be in there and slug it out and fight it out and work it out and, you know, do all that you need to do to make bring about those kinds of changes. So the political process, and it, believe me, it has its failings. I hate the fact that money is connected to politics because I think that's terrible and that's what makes us go in the wrong direction so many times. I'd love to take special interest out of the equation. That's not going to happen. So we have to build political leadership who are going to develop a tin ear to some of those things. They're always going to be there and always going to be available, but that are going to be rooted and have a passion in the people they represent and the duty that they have. And so I really believe that the process, as difficult as it is really, that's the way to go. We are a wonderful democracy that is envied by every country. People want to come here. There are things that we need to fix every single day, and we are part of fixing it every day and creating more equality every day. But you got to get in there, and even if you're not going to be elected, that you're going to support good candidates, that you're going to vote for good candidates, that you're going to roll up your sleeves and be a good voter. It is a system that only works if people participate, and we have to make every single effort to get everyone to participate at every level. But it has to be, you have to have a stake in it. It can't just be, I only vote for the good guys. I only vote certain times. I vote every single time, no matter what. I study the issues. I may not like the range of candidates. You don't have to vote for every single office, but you do have to vote every single time. There are important decisions that you need to make. And so I really believe in our democratic system, and I have a lot of faith in it. Like I said, it isn't perfect, but it is the best we have, and it's a democracy that is you can't trade it in for anything else. It's the only way to go, is that everybody has to have a stake in the system.
How do you assess the political moment that we're in now? We just went through a presidential campaign where there were those, if you will, on the right who were very critical of the political establishment, which, if you'll permit me, to a degree you've been part of in particular ways. There were those on the left who were equally critical of the political establishment and even of their own political leaders. And, you know, you've been there over many years and you've worked very hard and you've pursued legislation. How do you view this particular moment that our country is in right now, especially in light of the last presidential campaign?
Well, I'm very troubled by it all. I, as a lifelong Democrat, as a former vice chair of the Democratic Party, I'm troubled by my own party in how it just did not stick to its own philosophy of who they are, representing working families and working, individuals. It seemed to have really been more attentive to the special interests, more moneyed interest, not working the grassroots, not organizing the grassroots, not listening to the minority participation of African Americans, of Latinos, of others that are good Democrats, but you can't take us for granted. So they failed in many ways. But I'm very, very troubled with just the dynamics of the dialogue, of how raw it was and how people got away in this discussion, in these debates, with making statements that were false, not being informed on issues, people just standing up and running, and the name calling that went on. You know, it seemed to be a disrespect to everyone, to voters and otherwise, that was, which has led people to be more divided, more polarized than ever before, instead of really getting the kind of inspiring leadership that you needed at the top, that was sending a message to everyone that we were all going to have, who am I going to vote for? I like both of them, and this is better than the other. Instead, it was, God, I hate both of them. What am I going to do? Who am I going to vote for? What am I going to do? There was a feeling there. So even a lot of people who supported Democrats or supported Republicans, there was sort of a misgiving. There wasn't a surety that was provided. And of course, the outcome was very painful for me because I really was troubled how how as a Democrat, we lost so many of the traditional states that meant that we were not speaking to those people, that there was a feeling that people had been left behind. That is not the party I want to be a part of. I want to be a part of a party that understands its duty and its responsibility to the grassroots, to the working man and woman out there, to working families, and to understand their plight. And while we can say, you know, we have these environmental rules, how do you transition those coal miners? I mean, where are they going to? You don't just say, let's eliminate coal altogether and not think about all the families that are affected by it. And we as a party we're almost saying that when we start looking at all that we needed to do, we were leaving people behind, and we didn't realize it by, you know, looking at, oh, well, those conservative states are just farmers and farmland and rural areas. No. We needed to listen to everybody. We weren't going to win everybody's vote, but we needed to organize and strategize and find a way. So we had a lot of work to do. And, of course, the outcome has led to a much more divided country that we have today, which is painful. And seeing, for someone who's been involved in civil rights for decades, to see them eroding, to see it potentially taking steps backwards, potentially going back to that kind of divisive kind of, you know, that while nationality could be a positive thing, they're looking at it, you know, them and us, and separating ourselves. We're a country of immigrants that people have forgotten about, and all of a sudden an immigrant is a bad word. Instead of being proud of being able to attract the best and the brightest from all over to come here and to work together and to have the kind of diversity, all of a sudden it's a negative word. And I'm concerned about that. And we have a lot of work to do, not only as a Democratic Party, but we really need to reach out to young people, and young people need to reach out to us. We need to listen, that we both of us need to listen to each other. But I think what we need to do is we need to recognize and understand and have more accountability. When people are looking at just D.C. changing everything, that's not where it's at. We need to change our own attitude in our own neighborhoods and our own community. Even though there's espousing all kinds of separatism and divisive things, we have to look at our own neighborhoods as well. So we all have a duty as well to make sure that we don't, you know, become part of that. We need to change it, and it starts in our own neighborhoods, in our own homes. It isn't just Washington's going to change and trickle down. It's the other way around. Hopefully it's going to change, but it starts at our own neighborhood and our own communities.
What advice would you give for the next generation of public leaders? Those who are interested in the country generally, those who are interested in specific constituencies, Latino communities, gay lesbian communities, the business sector, religious conservatives, you know, we have all these different groups, right? What advice would you give the person who is in elective office, in a position to make a difference? What advice would you give them today to be the best leader they can be?
Yeah. Well, I really think they have to work. There are a lot of elected officials who just love riding along. You know, they show up to vote, they do these certain kinds of things, they raise a lot of money, they love the glamour aspect of it, but they don't really, you know the issues well enough. They don't study the issues well enough. They buy into whatever their caucus says or whatever their party says. You need more independent thinking. And I don't think that's anti-party or partisan. You can still be a Democrat but be an independent thinker. You have to care about your constituents and their point of view. And you have to empower those forces to be with you and to be supportive of you, but at the same time, you have to be responsible to them and carry that forward in your work every single day. So it's a tough job being elected official. And there are many that are not working hard at it. And then you have to be able to deal with the accountability. people should hold you accountable, and you should be take pride in the fact that you are being held accountable every single day to do the right thing, to do the best thing for your constituents. And so once you know you have those duties and responsibilities and that you're going to be held to that standard, probably not as many people would go into politics at two today. Some of them come across it and are saying, oh my God, I didn't know I had to go to this many meetings and work so hard and do all of these things. It's a tough job. But I hope that they are inspired by their own personal power. Because the thing is that once you're an elected official, you have unbelievable power. And I hope it inspires you to really work hard at it. Since you have been given all of this power, people have entrusted all this power on you, the duties and the responsibilities are even greater. You need to take it very seriously. Every vote is important. You have to know why you voted. You can't just say, well, you know, we don't read every bill that comes across our desk. That's not an answer. I mean, you know, you have to be able to say, my staff read it, understood it, this is my position. Whatever it is, you can't just sit around. I know that we pass legislation at the end of the day. Members of Congress are passing 200 bills in a day. When I was in the legislature, that happened. But we do have to take ownership and responsibility and be a part of it, because the power is so significantly important. And when people have voted for you and trust you, you have to walk around with, I don't say it's a burden, but you have to walk around with that mantle on every single day to remind yourself. And you're going to be lured, and the special interests are going to be there. Oh, come this way, have dinner with us, talk. And it's going to be tough, because it's just always so tempting to go and take an easy path. And, oh, well, he said this and he said that, and but he's a good friend. He gave me so much money and he helped me in my campaign. I really have to stand by him. We need to stand up to those forces. We need to recognize who we are and why we got here, and then I just understand it as duty and responsibility. When you're elected, there's duty and responsibility, and you have no duty to listen to a lobbyist. You have no responsibility to take money that's presented to you. None of those things have to happen. Your only duty and responsibility you have is to representing your constituents and governing responsibly every single day. That's your job. The rest of it, granted, if you don't have money, you can't get elected. You have to create balance there as well. But understand that there are great, great people who have been elected who have been able to overcome those issues. You will inspire and motivate people to give you money that doesn't have to come from tainted special interests that want something from you every single moment.
Based on your 40-year career, what would you say is the greatest challenge confronting those who want to help Latino communities continue to be major contributors to American society and take responsibility for the impact they're going to have, currently have, and are going to have even more because of the demographic growth that Latino communities are experiencing in the American population? What do you think is the best, what is the best place to focus on right now, or the greatest barrier, greatest challenge?
Well, there's a lot of barriers and a lot of challenges, but I think that we have to understand that our future is going to demand that we as Latinos be the leaders, that we be prepared to be leaders. In whatever profession, whatever career path we decide to take, that we need to play a leadership role there, whether it be in politics, whether it be on Wall Street, whether it be in entertainment, in science, in whatever career path it is. There is an expectation that we need to lead this country. We are going to be the majority population in this country. We're going to have a duty very, very soon if you look at the statistics and the numbers. So our responsibility to leadership is really essential. So preparing young people, preparing individuals to understand that duty and that responsibility, not just the power that goes with that, because that can be very corrupting in many, many ways, but recognizing and understanding our responsibility to that leadership role, and then recognizing that while you're a Latino or a Latina, you're not governing, you're not utilizing your power exclusively for Latinos and Latinas. You have to talk about you're now responsible and governing for all. There are a lot of people today who are elected to office that are just because they're whatever their position, they think that's all they do. You have to understand that once you're elected, you have a duty to everyone within your constituency and with people that you govern. So leadership is going to be very, very essential, and recognizing and understand. But again, leadership isn't just It's knowing what to do, how to do it. It's being prepared to lead. It's inspiring. You just don't get elected and then just continue to be negative. You have to inspire and motivate people. There are tremendous duties, and you have to take accountability and ownership of these things. So when we talk about leadership, it isn't just, you know, saying I'm going to take and do these following things and I'm going to get elected, or I'm going to do these following things and then I'm going to be a lawyer and I'm going to do this. It is, how are you going to step into the leadership helm? And once I get there, what are going to be my duties and responsibilities? And what's my vision? What's my passion? What do I want to change? How do I want to provide that leadership? I think that as Latinos, it is so critical to start thinking of ourselves, where are we going to be in 50 years? And in 50 years, we potentially are going to be the majority population in this country. We're going to be called upon to be leaders in all of these areas and arenas. And so consequently, preparing our young people now to be effective leaders, getting them armed and skilled with the right values, the integrity, and the responsibility that goes with it is going to be essential, because they're going to be at the helm of ruling this great country and providing leadership. The worst thing that could happen is that we'd be a majority population, but we are still kind of in a secondary role when it comes to power and responsibility and duty. So we need to be prepared for that. So while all of those issues, healthcare, the economy, you know, education, all of those issues are important, I think that today at the forefront is preparing our young people, preparing for our leadership responsibilities that we're going to have to take ownership of in the next 20 to 25 years. Critical, significant roles that we have to understand and respect, and not just know that they're going to be there and we have to take on. It's owning up to this, having a stake in it, having the responsibility, and being prepared to lead and to motivate.
So I'm done with my questions. Is there anything else you'd like to add? But it's been a lovely and fascinating and informative conversation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else you'd like to add?
Well, only to say that I think that the university here, as well as the position that you're in, are in a great position to really take us to that next level in developing young people who understand the duties and responsibilities of leadership, who are going to build the courage and the fortitude to struggle forward. I'm just proud of the work that you're doing here. I'm hoping to do it at home as well, because I truly believe that until we start talking to these young people and they know what they're up against and they're prepared to do it, I am grateful for the work that I've done, and I hopefully have created a standard and a following that people will respect. I respect my work, but more so that they're going to kick it up a notch and be stronger and more effective than ever before, that they're prepared to lead, and that they're going to be the generation that is really going to make the dramatic change that we all want to see, and to continue to be the wonderful country that we are and the world power that we should be, and that we're going to find a way that to bring more harmony and peace to our country and to our world. I think they can do it.
Gloria Molina, leader of Southern California politics and politics generally, thank you for your leadership and for your example, for your commitment, for your sacrifice.
Thank you.
And for your inspiration.
Thank you.
We all benefit from it.
Well, I've enjoyed it. I'm so grateful for the opportunity.
Thank you.
It's been wonderful.